Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat, episode 319, featuring part two of an interview with the great artist, Mr. Jim Sachs. This part of the interview, we talk about his days at CinemaWare, working on Defender of the Crown, and all the shenanigans that went on around that game. We also talk about Ports of Call, and a little bit about Centurion, and much, much more. Anyway, there's a lot of great stuff in this segment, so without further ado, here is Mr. Jim Sachs.
When did you get this? Your first Amiga? Was it the Amiga 1000?
Yes. I still have it.
Oh, cool. Yeah, do you still have those graph paper drawings you were talking about?
They got stolen. I was giving art classes, computer art classes, and which is funny because, you know, here I came from ground zero, and then within a year or two, I'm traveling around the country giving seminars on how to do that kind of thing. Anyway, I use those. I would, when I give the seminars, I would put those big graph paper sheets up on the board. And during one of the seminars, I went out to lunch, came back, and they were gone.
So, man, you've had a tough luck, you know, with those pirates and people even just physically stealing your stuff. Wow. That's just terrible. I can't believe it. I mean, that's just horrible. Yeah, I think it's fascinating, too, about this. You're traveling around with these seminars. I was kind of playing with this. I was imagining what this must have been like. I sort of came up with the idea of you as a sort of Bob Ross of, in a Joy of Deluxe painting.
It was similar to that, yeah.
I guess, did you work with anybody that went on to become a famous graphics artist?
Well, let's see. When I left CinemaWare, I only did the one game for CinemaWare, and then I had discovered Rob Landeros and left him as art director in charge of CinemaWare, and then he did countless games for them after that. So he got a good name. Then he went on to form Trilobite and created the game The Seventh Guest and The 11th Hour. So, yeah, he got up there in stature.
Yeah, he made some money with those games, that's for sure.
Yeah, they did.
Well, let's talk a little bit then about Defender of the Crown. Definitely one of my favorite games for the Amiga. It was one of the first games, I think, we purchased for that. I'm guessing that game probably sold more Amigas, you know, than anything else Commodore could have done, right? Okay. And it was really all about your artwork. It's what makes that game stand out. You know, again, all those lovely backdrops, the castles, the maidens, you know, all of this stuff, amazing stuff. Now, what was it like for you, I mean, behind the scenes, creating all this artwork?
It was a heady time. It's every day I'd get up and see things on a computer screen that no one had ever seen before. It's just, you know, in all of human evolution, I was looking at things, you know, lighting up pixels and getting effects, color cycling and things like that that no one had ever seen before. And so I couldn't wait to get up every morning, which was a good thing because I only got 4 hours sleep each night working on Defender of the Crown. Bob Jacob, the producer, would call me at 2 a.m. to make sure I was still working. And I was. So, yeah, it was great. It was, I would just sit there in front of the computer for 20 hours a day and my wife would bring me sandwiches and drinks and just program graphics all day.
What were some of these? You mentioned some of the effects that you had never seen before. You said the color cycling and what else was that?
Well, moving objects across other objects, moving detailed bitmaps across a detailed background and seeing the background through the alpha channel, through the holes in the object that you're moving. You didn't see that on any other computers up to that point. So it was just great being able to grab something as a brush in Deluxe Paint and just stamp it down to see how it's going to look on a certain background. It was just unprecedented. You know, mainframes could do that, but not a personal computer.
Must have been a giant leap from the graph paper days to this technology.
Oh, yeah. It's incredible, sure.
What was Kellen Beck like?
Kellen Beck is great. He's still a friend of mine. I saw him last month. He lives up in Portland now. Kellen already had the idea for Defender of the Crown and had already drawn storyboards when I met him. So he and Bob Jacob knew each other from when Kellen worked at Epics. and Bob Jacob was a an artist manager, artist agent. So they had gotten together and decided to make a company that would do cinematic style games. And for some reason, as an art director, my name just kind of floated to the top. You know, they looked around, and a lot of my graphics were already on, I can't really say the internet, because such a thing didn't exist yet, but users groups, magazines had printed my artwork. And so they came to me, and we flew together that first day up to Commodore in the Bay Area, or up to Amiga, and talked to a couple people up there about possibly programming this game. And R.J. Mako was not our first contact up there. There was another programmer who I won't mention because he failed completely and didn't take it seriously, and thought that he could just swoop in at the last minute and do all the programming for the game, and it just wasn't true at all. It was a lot more extensive than he had planned. So we switched to R.J. Michael, and he accepted it and pretty much saved the project.
Yeah, he's got to be one of the best programmers around, huh?
Yeah.
Did you like working with him?
R.J. was difficult for me to work with. He was highly temperamental at the time. He's a great guy now, very laid back. He didn't like the idea of working 16 hours a day on that project. And since I was working 20 hours a day, it sounded like a paid vacation to me. So we had a couple of blow-ups on the phone. And still are to this day. I saw him a couple months ago at the Big Amiga reunion. And I gave him one of the original discs. He signed R.J. Michael, the test discs for the first scene, which was a scene that he had programmed. I would lay everything out and have it working in Aegis Animator and send it to him by FedEx. There's no internet, remember then. So he would get that disc and then program it in to look exactly like I had it working on the on Aegis Animator. He said he loved working like that. So and then he'd send it back to me and to Bob Jacob and Kellen Beck. So that's how it worked, scene by scene, until the whole thing was done.
It's just hard to imagine that, you know, with today of the internet, I guess it's simplified this so much.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
Waiting
now
for a FedEx package.
Yeah. It was very difficult, especially since I'd be so sleepy and without having any sleep the night before. And I'd have to drive it all the way down to Ontario Airport, trying to stay awake on the freeway while I take that disc to FedEx at Ontario to get it to RJ the next morning. Very tough.
What was the reason for these insane work days? I mean, what was the big rush?
Bob had some very serious investors, the kind that you don't want to be late on a project. I won't say mafia, I won't say anything like that, but some people that definitely were not willing to wait past the original deadline that he had specified for them, which was insanely close. It was just, we did the whole thing in just a couple months. And you know, when you're, he didn't really see it. He and Phyllis, who was his producing partner, his wife, did not see it as quite as groundbreaking as Kellen and I did, and RJ, I guess, too. So until it came out, until we were really almost done with it, and then they realized it was just far beyond anything that anybody else was doing. So that was their excuse for not paying me more royalties. Oh, well, we didn't know you'd do such a good job. So, you know, I only did the one project for them. Didn't like the way I was treated and left.
Yeah, that's a real missed opportunity on their part, you know.
They continued. They had a pretty good run. I set the tone, and then Rob Landeros kind of took it from there. And they did, you know, a lot of good games. Sinbad, King of Chicago, Wings.
I guess we know where the inspiration for King of Chicago came from, huh?
That was Doug Sharp. He had already had that game out, I guess, on the Mac. But he did a version for Cineware.
Who were those women in the game based on? And I was also wondering if you had a favorite.
The first one, who is still the best one, is Catherine, the dark-haired one. And her face was based on, I forget what her name is. She was the female star of NYPD Blue. Can't remember the name, but anyway, the face is based on her, and then the hair and the neck bones were my wife. So then I'd see women in magazines, pictures, makeup, women's magazines and stuff, and just say, oh, that's a good face. I'll use the eyes from that, the mouth from that, and then so the different women were just put together that way. One thing that's really frustrating I'd like to mention is that the Amiga aspect ratio is not the same as current computers. So when you see these images on an original Amiga screen, they're very tall and in normal aspect ratio. When you see them on modern screens, everything's very wide. Mm-hmm. Because it's right now it's 320 by 240, and back then it was 320 by 200. So it just is very frustrating to me to see all these pictures that I did in magazines and on modern computer screens that are stretched so wide that people think I drew them that way. And no, people weren't short and fat like that. You know, I drew them in normal aspect ratio. So I wish people would take that into consideration, but nobody ever seems to anymore.
Well, I'll make sure in this video when I show them that they're their proper aspect ratio.
Great.
Let's talk a little bit before moving on. I want to talk a little bit about Defender of the Crown 2, which must have been, again, a very frustrating experience. I think you did. I read some, you even did a new musical score for it.
Right, yeah.
So you're a musician on top of all these other...
I do whatever it takes. I'm just a guy that is fairly resourceful, and whatever it takes to get the job done and just knock it out of the ballpark, I do it. You know, if I want to make a movie, I have to write the screenplay. I never wrote a screenplay before. So I wrote a screenplay, and that's just step one of making the movie. So with Defender of the Crown 2, writing the musical score, I didn't have rights, for one thing, to use Jim Cuomo's musical score. So I had to write my own. And plus, you know, I consider the original be good for the time, but it sounds an awful lot like just computer clicks and beeps to me. So I wanted a full orchestral musical score. So I got a Studio 16 soundboard from Anthony Wood, and created instruments and everything, and it's pretty good. For that time, it's very good. But now there are much more realistic sound samplers and everything out there. But for the time, it's pretty darn good. And wrote all new, for every scene, it's got its own background music. I rewrote all the code so that there's none of R.J. Michael's original code in it. Wrote it in a program called The Director, which was from a guy named Keith Doyle, Right Answers Group. And that's only on the Amiga, the Director programming language. And then did some new scenes. There's a scene of the outside of the castle of the main knight's bedroom, so that after he's won the maiden, it goes to the outside scene, you know, where you can see the fire flickering through the window and everything, and the flag is up, which is a symbol for his roommate not to come home because he's got a girl in there. And so I added that scene, and that was a pretty extensive one, and then redid the Robin Hood scene. Rob Landeros, that's the original Defender of the Crown, has a scene of Robin Hood by a campfire, and Rob Landeros did that scene. I didn't do it. That was after I left Commodore, and they added one more scene to it, or after I left Cineware. And I never liked that scene, and plus it was done by somebody else, so I had to redo it for Defender of the Crown 2. So I got a Robin Hood costume from a Halloween place, and I kneeled down in front of a fire outside, and snapped some photos, and then hand drew it from that using myself as a model. And then just redid basically everything in the game, changed the scenario of the game, where instead of trying to become King of England, which I always felt was unrealistic, you are trying to raise a ransom to get Richard the Lionhearted back from Austria, where he's been captured. And that's historically accurate. Mm-hmm. That actually happened. So The story is still basically Ivanhoe, but now you're trying to raise money, which makes it very similar to Ports of Call, which I learned that, you know, people got addicted to that game because of the money aspect of it. So I think it would have been a stronger game if Commodore hadn't folded about 2 days after it came out.
Yeah, so what had happened there? So CinemaWare was gone, and Commodore had acquired the rights to the Defender of the Crown?
Not really. Gail Wellington at Commodore came to me, and I suggested, since CinemaWare was gone, and I never got any royalties anyway, that they were in default, and I'm taking repossession of all my graphics. I could just use it in a new game, write a new scenario, all new music, new programming. So she said, okay, gave me a little money up front. Took me a year to do all that. It's in five languages also. I hired voice actors to do all the narration and everything in five different languages on the same CD. And so it took me a year. Commodore printed it up, published it, went out of business. Just almost the same day. I think it would have done really well if it stuck around.
Yeah, I noticed there's some unauthorized copies floating around, you know, the internet. You ever thought about going back to that game and, you know, doing something with that?
Never really thought about going back to anything. There's so much in the future, and I'm so old already that I really got to start my real career before it gets too late.
All right, so you did the graphics for another one of my favorite Amiga games, Ports of Call. Yeah, I was definitely one of the people that was addicted to that one, like you said. I played this with my dad. We'd play a two-player mode and be up all night, you know, with this game. How'd you end up working on this one?
Well, I was already involved with Aegis Development and Bill Volk. That was a game that was submitted to them by two German guys, Rolf Dieterklein and Martin Ulrich. With graphics and everything. It was a completely finished, playable game. And then Aegis, the graphics were just horrible. It was, you know, unwatchable. So Aegis suggested that they have me redo all the graphics for it, and they come out with it under the Aegis label, and that's what happened.
I noticed they're still selling the game on their website.
Really? I haven't noticed. You know, we were going to do another one after that. That got really successful. That was Aegis's biggest seller. And then we were going to do a trucking version of the same thing. And Rolf Dieterklein flew over to California from Germany. And I took him around to all the different the Freightliner dealer and all that kind of stuff. So we could photograph the insides of trucks. And it was just going to be exactly like Ports of Call, except trucking around the United States. And then Aegis imploded after that, so it never happened.
Well, that's too bad. That would have been awesome.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I definitely would have played that. I'm not really familiar with this game, Centurion Defender of Rome. But I guess that's another one that you worked on, right?
Yeah, Kellen Beck did that one for Electronic Arts, and he called me up and he said, these guys can't get the graphics, you know, can you do a few of the graphics for me? And so I did. And probably did about a quarter of the graphics in the game and sent it off, and just piecemeal, you know, just piecework. Just pay me by the screen. I'm not sure if my name was even mentioned in it, but it worked out okay.
And that's all for this week's episode. I hope you guys enjoyed that. Should be back next week with part three. I think this is going to be the final segment coming up next week with Mr. Sachs. After that, another retrospective, and then we'll have to see who I can get lure onto the show for another interview series, so stay tuned for that. As always, I want to thank you very much for your support of the show, guys. It means everything to me, so thank you again and again for that. I want to welcome a couple of new patrons. We've got Andreas Sayer and Jim Page. So thank you, Andreas and Jim, very much for stepping up to the plate. If you want to be like those cool guys, just go to that link in the show notes to the Patreon site, and you could support the show at any amount that you think it's worth and that you can afford. So thank you very much for that. So what about that news from the Matt Cave? Lots of news this week. We've got, first up here, a new Psychonauts game in the works, Psychonauts 2. This is Tim Schafer's project. They're funding it through something called Fig. Not really sure what the deal is with that. Why that instead of Kickstarter? You guys might be able to inform me. I guess I could have looked it up, but I just didn't have time. But anyway, the game looks pretty neat. You can go look at the trailer for it. They're trying to raise $3.3 million. Seems like a lot to me. They're up to $1.7 million already with 37 days to go. It costs $40. This is the cheapest tier that'll get you a copy, a digital download of the game when it comes out. You know, these figures, they look a little inflated to me, I have to say. But I guess a new Psychonauts game would be worth it for many people. Also, Full Throttle Remastered is coming out for the PS4, Vita, and the PC, apparently. This was a 2016 release. I really like the original Full Throttle game. So this is looking pretty cool. It's supposed to have updated graphics, new controls, and everything. So keeping an eye on that. Also, Adam, you might know him from the Fragments of Silicon, Silicon podcast. He's just done an interview series with our good friend Becky Berger Heinemann. A very extensive set of interviews. He said he's got stuff on there that she's never talked about anywhere else. So I'll post a link to that in the show notes. Really cool stuff. And then finally, Nathan wrote in about a big sale going on at GOG, GOG.com. As you know, I'm an affiliate of theirs. They have a couple of big bundles up. They got the bundles with the King's Quest games. They've got Best of Bullfrog a bundle with a Dungeon Keeper 1 and 2 on there. A bunch of other stuff, including a $3 mystery game. So just look for the link in the show notes. That'll take to the affiliate page. Won't cost you anything extra, and whatever you pick up, the show will get a little kickback. So anyway, like I said, lots of news. Okay, what about that ale of the week? Well, this week I've got another entry from Stone. This is their Choca Vesa, I believe is how you pronounce this, X-O-C-O-V-E-Z-A, for the holidays in the new year. This is stout, brewed with cocoa, coffee, peppers, vanilla, cinnamon, and nutmeg. So, a very interesting mix there with the peppers and the cocoa and coffee. I have no idea what this is going to taste like. It'll either be the really delicious or really terrible. Let's see. There's nothing like making a beer so beloved that people feel compelled to campaign for its return. So in the spirit of the holiday season, we are pleased to give our fans the number one item on their wish list. So I guess they must have made this before, and they're bringing it back. Let's see. First brewed in 2014. Chris Banker, blah, blah, blah. Creamy, semi-sweet milk stout. let's see. Okay. What else? Let's see how much alcohol is in it. 8.1% alcohol. So definitely on up there. Not crazy strong, but definitely on the stronger side. Anyway, definitely sounds interesting, and I'm kind of getting into a Christmas spirit here. So let's get this open and see what it's all about. All right, so I got some of this Choca Vesa here in the rather excellent drinking horn. Giving it a couple of good whiffs here. You can definitely smell the cinnamon and the nutmeg in this. A little bit of a cocoa-like aroma as well. Smells pretty good. Don't really smell those peppers, those chili peppers in it, though. Which I guess that might be a good thing. I hope they didn't overdo the chili peppers, because that would be kind of strange. I know there are those chili pepper beers out there. I've never really been a big fan of those. Anyway, let's give it a taste, see what it's all about. It's got a bit of a whang to it, let me tell you. You definitely taste the sort of a, almost like a sort of vague pumpkin-y, pumpkin pie-like taste to this. I guess that's the nutmeg and all those sorts of ingredients like that. I don't really taste any kind of heat from a pepper. Just mostly tasting like a nutmeg, cinnamon, cocoa, sort of a mix there. It's kind of a bit on the bitter side. It's very thick, a creamy texture. Let me try it again here. Gotta say, I'm not really liking the taste of this. I guess there must be people that really like this if they actually brought it back. It's kind of bitter, and you sort of get those sort of sweet tastes from some of those seasonings at the tail end there, but just not a real pleasant experience in my opinion. I'll try one more swig here. Yeah, it's not something I would want to drink a six pack of. Maybe if you just want something novelty flavor that doesn't taste like anything else, this would be a good pick. But I gotta say, it's not really appealing to me, this one, Choco Vesa. I'm gonna go maybe 2 out of 5 on this. It's not horrible, but just definitely kind of a weird mix of flavors. Not something I'd really enjoy drinking copious amounts of. Your mileage may vary, however, but for me, I'm going to go 2 out of 5 drinking horns on the Choco Vesa. So let's wrap this up with a quotation. And I was looking for quotes about ships because Jim worked on that Ports of Call game. And I found this really, really good one here. I think you'll enjoy this. It goes something like this. A ship in port is safe, but that's not what ships are built for. See you guys next week.
Let's talk about your reviews a little bit regarding intravenous DeMilo. This tasteless cover is a good indication of the lack of musical invention within. The musical growth rate of this band cannot even be charted. They are treading water in a sea of retarded sexuality and bad poetry.
Well, that's nitpicking, isn't it?